Hello everyone, welcome to my channel The Lab Rats. This is the second part of Drosophila melanogaster's developmental genetics. In this video, we will be discussing the development of anterior posterior axis in Drosophila melanogaster. For those who have not watched my first lecture on dorsal ventral axis development in Drosophila, I am providing the video link in the description box. Please watch that video, and if you like it, then do not forget to subscribe my channel for more upcoming videos. So let's get started with today's topic. So what are the different morphogens that helps in formation of anterior and posterior axis in Drosophila, and what are their roles? So morphogens are basically the product of pattern regulating genes. The morphogens are the protein that through their change in the local concentration or activity cause the surrounding tissue to take up a particular shape or structure. These morphogens forms pattern or gradient in the embryo based on which different body segments develop. So different body segment and their sequence in Drosophila are from the anterior to posterior axis. The segments are acron, head, thorax, abdomen, and telson or tail. The sequence of these body segments are determined by the pattern or concentration gradient of the morphogens. One of the type of pattern regulating genes are maternal genes that are expressed during oogenesis. So five most important maternal genes I'm going to discuss here. So bicoid and hunchback are involved in anterior axis formation and also in the head and thorax formation. Nanose and caudal helps in formation of posterior axis and in the development of abdomen. Torso helps in formation of anterior and posterior terminal, that is on the anterior end it helps in formation of acron, and on the posterior end it helps in formation of telson or tail. Also it helps in formation of most posterior abdomen segment and the most anterior head segment. So these are the maternal genes that helps in formation of anterior and posterior axis. But we should understand, or basically we should know, that apart from these maternal genes, there are various other protein and translational activators or repressors that helps in formation of anterior and posterior axis development. So those who have seen the first part of Drosophila's video must be familiar with this figure, where we have already discussed it in much detail. During oogenesis, nurse cells start expressing some of the maternal gene. The mRNA product of those maternal genes are transported to the oocyte, where they start determination of anterior and posterior axis even before the egg is fertilized. After fertilization, those mRNA are translated into the respective proteins. Now, if we talk about two major proteins, that are bicoid and nanose, they are synthesized in the nurse cell and transported to the oocyte with the help of microtubules and some other associated proteins. In case of bicoid, when it is in the nurse cell, it binds to two proteins, swallow protein and exoparenchial protein. These protein mRNA complex are transported to the oocyte with the help of kinesin ATPase motor protein and microtubules. Now, bicoid mRNA has 3' UTR sequence that are essential for its localization in the anterior end of the oocyte. So bicoid mRNA binds to dynein motor protein, which helps to transport it to the minus end of the microtubules that are situated in the anterior end of the oocyte. Now in case of nanose, Oscar mRNA and Stofan proteins are transported to the posterior end of the oocyte, where the positive end of the microtubules are situated. So there the Stofan protein translate Oscar mRNA into Oscar protein. This Oscar protein acts as a trap and binds to the nanose mRNA in the posterior end of the oocyte. Also, the nanose mRNA has 3' UTR sequence that helps it to bind to the cytoskeleton in the posterior end. In this way, nanose mRNAs are concentrated in the posterior end and bicoid mRNAs are concentrated into the anterior end of the oocyte. Just like bicoid and nanose, other maternal genes such as hunchback and caudal are also important for the formation of anterior posterior axis. Hunchback and caudal mRNA are synthesized in the nurse cell and then they are transported to the oocyte. But unlike bicoid and nanose, they are distributed ubiquitously in the syncytial blastoderm. This graph represents the mRNA molecule distribution of these four genes, that are bicoid, hunchback, caudal and nanose, in the oocyte before fertilization. So this represents the anterior end of the oocyte, this represents posterior end of the oocyte, and this represents concentration gradient of these four mRNA molecule. Here we can see that bicoid mRNA are primarily present on the anterior end, and as we move towards the posterior end, the concentration decreases and becomes negligible. Same in case of nanos mRNA, which are primarily present on the posterior end, and as we move towards the anterior end, the concentration decreases and eventually becomes negligible. But in case of hunchback and caudal, the concentration of these two proteins remain constant throughout the oocyte. So the question arises, if hunchback and caudal are ubiquitously distributed, then how do they define two different axes in the oocyte? To understand that, first we need to understand the pattern of bicoid and nanos protein in the early embryo. After fertilization, bicoid mRNA is translated to bicoid protein in the presence of cortex, groson, and stofan. Nanos mRNA is translated to nanos protein in the presence of OSCAR. When these two proteins are formed, they diffuse and forms a concentration gradient in the early embryo. This concentration gradient determines the concentration gradient of the protein which they affect, that is caudal and hunchback. See, when we say that bicoid is present in the anterior end or nanos is present at the posterior end, we does not mean that they are present as a spot or they are concentrated at one small location. By saying so, we mean that they are primarily present on their respective axis, but they diffuse and forms a concentration gradient in the early embryo body. On the basis of amount of these protein present at different location in the embryo, the intensity of their effect or the intensity of their role is seen. For example, we know that bicoid represses caudal. So where bicoid concentration is highest, the concentration of caudal is lowest. Where bicoid concentration is lowest, concentration of caudal is highest. So after fertilization, the pattern is something like this. Hunchback and bicoid forms a concentration gradient from anterior to the posterior end of the early embryo. The caudal and nanos protein forms a concentration gradient from posterior end to the anterior end of the early embryo. So how does this pattern is achieved? Basically, bicoid and nanos both are translational repressors. Bicoid protein binds to the 3' UTR of caudal mRNA and prevents its translation into caudal protein. So in the anterior end where bicoid is highest, it binds and suppresses the translation of caudal protein. As the concentration of bicoid decreases, concentration of caudal increases. Same in case of hunchback and nanos. Nanos suppresses the translation of hunchback indirectly. Nanos binds to pumilio, which is needed for the adenylation of hunchback mRNA and hence its translation into hunchback protein. So we can see here, in the anterior end, hunchback mRNA is adenylated in the presence of pumilio. And after adenylation, the mature mRNA is translated into hunchback protein, which leads to formation of anterior structures. In the posterior end, this pumilio interacts with nanos and the adenylation of hunchback mRNA is prevented. So, in the absence of adenylation, no translation takes place and no hunchback protein is formed. So, in the absence of hunchback, abdominal formation takes place. In this way, the concentration gradient of bicoid and nanos maintains the concentration gradient of caudal and hunchback protein as well. Now this is again displaying how different proteins are controlling each other's action on both the axes. So in a egg cytoplasm, the localized bicoid mRNA is translated to bicoid protein on the anterior axis. Localized nanos mRNA is translated to nanos protein on the posterior axis. After these proteins are formed, they diffuses to form a concentration gradient in the egg cytoplasm. Other two proteins, that are caudal and hunchback, also forms a concentration gradient based on the gradient of their regulators, that are bicoid and nanos. As we know that bicoid is a translational repressor of caudal protein, so as the concentration of bicoid decreases from anterior to posterior, the concentration of caudal increases from anterior to posterior. Same as the nanos is the translational repressor of hunchback, so as the concentration of nanos increases from anterior to posterior, the concentration of hunchback decreases from anterior to posterior. In case of pimulio, which is present throughout the egg cytoplasm, but because nanose is present on the posterior end and binds to pimulio and prevents its action, the activity of pimulio is restricted only on the anterior end, where it can annihilate the hunchback protein, hunchback mRNA, and helps in its translation. In this way, this regulatory circuit of different proteins maintains the anterior and posterior axis in the Drosophila. Now coming to this figure, this shows normal egg with normal bicoid concentration, which is showing that it is concentrated on the anterior end and diffusing as we go towards the posterior end. Now in the bicoid mutant, bicoid deficient mutant, no bicoid protein is seen. This is a graphical representation where we can see that the concentration of bicoid is highest on the anterior end, and as we move towards the posterior, the concentration is decreasing. Now in case of normal egg, a normal larva is formed where head is formed followed by thorax and abdomen and then tail is formed. But in case of bicoid deficient mutant, a double posterior larva is formed, that is on both the ends posterior organs are formed. So this larva forms a tail followed by two abdomens and again a tail. Also there are two different proteins that are huncbin and tailless that can form acorn only in the presence of bicoid. So as the bicoid is absent, so these two proteins helps in formation of tail again on the anterior end. In this way, a double posterior larva is formed in a bicoid deficient mutant. In this way, we can see how the proteins are needed to be present on their actual axis for the formation of proper body in Drosophila, body organs in Drosophila. So the last maternal gene that we will be discussing is torso. Torso is a transmembrane protein and helps in formation of terminal segments on the anterior and posterior end of the Drosophila. This torso also encodes for receptor tyrosine kinase and gets activated by the anterior and posterior follicle cells. These anterior posterior follicle cells express torso-like proteins which can cross the perivitelline layer, and on the egg membrane they activate torso, which encodes for receptor tyrosine kinase and hence activates our RTK cascade. This RTK cascade or the activation of torso helps in formation of terminal zygotic genes, that is tailless and huncbin. This tailless and huncbin helps in formation of acorn on the anterior end of the Drosophila and telson on the posterior end of the Drosophila. So in comparison to the wild type, which forms acorn, head, thoracic, abdominal and then telson segment, a torso deficient Drosophila, that is that Drosophila which do not forms torso gene, has only head, thoracic and abdominal segment. Also you should note that those Drosophilas that are deficient in bicoid gene, they do not form acorn on the anterior end, as in the absence of bicoid, these terminal zygotic genes do not form acorn, rather they form telson only. So now talking about this whole table, apart from knowing which maternal gene helps in anterior, posterior or the terminal segment formation, we should also have a knowledge that at what developmental stage these maternal genes are expressed. So during oogenesis, all these maternal genes starts expressing themselves and they form maternal mRNA, which helps in determining the axis. After fertilization, by the time syncytial blastoderm is formed, these mRNAs are translated into proteins that form protein gradient in the early embryo. This protein gradient helps in determining the sequences in which the body segments will form, and hence they helps in development of anterior posterior axis of the Drosophila. So this is how these three maternal gene products, that are bicoid, nanose and torso, helps in formation of anterior, posterior and terminal segments respectively in Drosophila. Thank you so much for your patience. I hope this video was useful. If you have any question, please feel free to comment in the comment section. And do not forget to hit the bell icon for updates and the upcoming videos.